God fall afresh on all of us this morning. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing unto you. Amen. Jeremiah is not a book that we spend that much time on. I think there are a couple things that, whether we recognize it or not, we know from the book of Jeremiah. One that comes to mind. Now, I grew up going to Southern Baptist Church a lot. You all know that. We used to have something we called sword drills. Has anybody heard of sword drills?
Yes, we used to have
them. Yeah, the Bible is your sword. So, sword drills was the Sunday school teacher would yell out a verse, and you had to be the first one to find it in your Bible. And then, when we got even more intense, we would do competitions to see who had memorized verses. It still gets to the point where whenever I hear or read Psalm 23, one of the first verses I memorized, I get an intense need for a Tootsie Roll, because that was my reward when I memorized the verse. But one of the verses that I memorized early, and that many of us probably know fairly well, is Jeremiah 29:11. For surely I know the plans I have for you. You all thought I was going to make you see who's found it first among you. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. That's a very well-known verse. It's a verse that we've probably heard before. Some people might have it on their wall. The other thing from Jeremiah that we might know is a hymn. If my allergies weren't bothering me so much, I might try and sing it, but I'm not going to. 501 in our chalice hymnal, there is a balm in Gilead. You all know that one, right? There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. That's the chorus. So there are a couple things we know from Jeremiah. You know, both those are really kind of positive, uplifting things, right? That song, that hymn, and for surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare, not for harm. Those are both very positive. So, if that's all we know of Jeremiah, we don't really have a good idea of what Jeremiah is about. And I feel like that might be all some of us know about Jeremiah. And so if I came with this verse today, surely the days are coming, says the Lord, also very positive and hopeful on its surface, then I wouldn't be doing a very good service, I think. I feel like we need to get a better idea about Jeremiah before we look specifically at our verse. Now, the problem with the Jeremiah 29:11 is it is almost always taken out of context. When people say, I know the plans I have for you, right? They're missing what's really going on. But that out of context pales in comparison to the balm in Gilead hymn. That's taking way out of context. So, Jeremiah is a book about grief and pain and loss. And yes, the book ends hopeful, and we move into that with our verse today. But the majority of the book is not hopeful. And the verse with the balm in Gilead reference is not hopeful. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I'm talking real grief, not the March Madness grief that many of us are feeling this morning, that Ryan will feel later this afternoon when Auburn beats Clemson. Although, I don't know, somebody has a Michigan thing on the front of their car. They're not feeling grief. That was an exciting thing. But this is not about March Madness grief. So let's look real quick at Jeremiah 8. 18 through 9:1. If I had planned better, I'd have had them put up, but I'm just going to read it to you. They're in, it's in your Bibles if you want to look for it. But I'm going to read it real quick to you. My joy is gone. Grief is upon me. My heart is sick. Hark, the cry of my poor people from far and wide in the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their images, with their foreign idols? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of my poor people, I am hurt, I mourn, and dismay has taken hold of me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has the health of my poor people not been restored? Oh, that my head were a spring of water, and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I might weep day and night for the slain of my poor people. Now, that's not very helpful. Context. Jeremiah is writing in the midst of the exile to Babylon, the devastating loss of Jerusalem to the Babylonians, the destruction of the temple, the beginning of 70 years of exile. The prospect of this catastrophic invasion overwhelmed Jeremiah with sorrow. It made him weak. He couldn't get over his anguish. He could hear his people in captivity crying out bitterly. They would be longing for Jerusalem, where their God was, their true king. Why was God not helping them? They remembered God. Now they were appalled that they had provoked God, that they had worshipped images and idols. I like that some commentators look at the beginning of this part in Jeremiah and say that Jeremiah is actually quoting God here. So when I hear my people and I mourn with them, it's God saying that. And I think there's probably some truth to that. We grieve, but God is actually there grieving with us. When we wonder where God is in our pain and our hurt, a lot of times I think God is actually right there in pain and hurting with us. And so we can't see it because we're blinded by our own pain and grief. But that God is actually feeling that pain and grief right there alongside us. And I really like that reading of this verse. There's also something else here that I think Jeremiah, or perhaps God, wants to point out to us. That's our own culpability in the situations that we sometimes get ourselves mired in. Sometimes it's our own actions that lead us into the pain that we're feeling. I didn't have to pick Virginia to go on further. it reminds me of a joke. There's a flood that is rising up in the land, and one man says, "Well, I know God is going to deliver me from this flood." And so people are coming by and saying, "We need to go because the flood's coming, and our street is going to be underwater. Don't worry about me. God will take care of me." So they leave him, and now the waters rise, and he has to be on the second floor of his house. Well, a canoe comes by his second story window. Get in, I've got room, I can get you out. Don't worry about me. God's going to take care of me. Are you sure I can? No. I know God will take care of me. Well, the waters continue to rise, so he gets on the roof. And as he's losing roof space, a helicopter comes by. And they lower down a ladder. They're like, "Come on, we see you. We're here. We're here to help. Climb the ladder. Don't worry about me. God is going to save me." And the helicopter flies away, and the waters continue to rise, and the man drowns. So the man gets up to heaven and sees God, and he says, "God, where were you? I had faith, I believed, I was sure you were going to save me." And God says, "Well, I sent your neighbors, Then I sent a man in a canoe, and then I sent a helicopter. I don't know what more you want from me. Sometimes the situations we're in are due to our own actions or non-actions. And Jeremiah is recognizing that the time for divine deliverance has come and gone. The Lord left them exposed to judgment as grain left standing after the harvest. There's a commentator who wrote, there's a popular proverb that was used in daily life when men encountered a helpless situation from which no deliverance or escape seemed possible. So Jeremiah pictured the people of Judah as having passed by one opportunity after another to repent of their rebellious ways. And so they have to either be delivered or saved from the coming judgment. Those are the only choices left. And then we get to the balm in Gilead. Now the hymn is very hopeful, but the verse is very different. Is there no balm in Gilead? The balm referred to as the resin or the gum of a storax tree, and it was used medicinally, and it was found in Gilead. But the scripture is saying, well, if there's this balm in Gilead, why aren't we being healed? Aren't there physicians? Why aren't we being healed? No help is here, and no help appears to be coming. So all we can do is weep. We can't even do that as well as we might like. For there aren't enough tears for the weeping that we need to do. You know, we don't focus on weeping much, or talk about it, or talk about grief. But sometimes a real good cry is very therapeutic. You can go see Wrinkle in Time if you need a good cry. But it's unusual today to find tears being talked about either in the pulpit or in the pews. The emphasis often seems to be on joy, as if talking about good things will make everything better. Sometimes we need to recognize where we are, and we need to live in that moment, and we need to cry. Now, Jeremiah does eventually get to a hopeful place, as we saw in our scripture today, and as the oft-quoted and well-known 29:11. But as I said, that's taken out of context, too. If we looked a few verses, well, really, if we looked a few verses before, we went up to 29:4. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent to exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. So we see immediately that 29:11 is not a personal scripture. If this was back before my really starting to think about inclusive language and the way I grew up in Chicago, I would say this is a you guys scripture. And then, you know, I started to learn inclusivity, and Texas, of course, taught me a better way to talk about plural people. This is a y'all scripture. Do we do y'all intimacy? All right, good. This is a y'all scripture. It's the plural pronoun you. The verse right before 29:11, 29:10 says, "For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed, will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plan I have for you," right? And we get into it. But if you miss that first part, you're missing what's really going on. See, it's not an immediate thing. God doesn't give us what we want when we want it. God's calendar is different from our calendar, and this is on God's timetable. So yes, the hope is there. That doesn't necessarily mean it's right now. God will deliver us. God will bring us out of the despair, but there's work to be done first in the despair. We must work through our grief in order to be ready to move forward. We must understand our own culpability in order to move forward, and we must know what we need to do better in the future so that we can avoid finding ourselves in this place again. So we must grieve, we must recognize our mistakes. And Jeremiah pointed this out, not to blame, but in order to change. So with this in mind, let's think about our text today. The days are surely coming when God's kingdom is here on earth as it is in heaven. We are not in those days yet. The days will come when there will be seeds sown, when there will be building and planting to the benefit of everyone. We are not in those days. Now we find ourselves, unfortunately, in the time of plucking up, of breaking down, of overthrowing and destroying, and the bringing in of evil. And when I read that this week, when I read the words about what God has seen done versus what God will do, I felt familiarity with what God has seen done and what's going on in our world right now. The days are coming of a covenant that we actually uphold on our end, and not just God upholding it on God's end, but we are not yet in those days. The days are coming. They are not here yet. We still have grieving to do. We still have things for which we have to take responsibility. When our elected officials work against the needs of the people, well, who voted for those officials? We have to take responsibility. Now, we do see more people getting involved. More people voted in primaries, in the primaries that have already taken place throughout the United States. More people voted in those primaries than voted in the last actual midterm elections. More people voted in the primaries for the upcoming midterm elections than voted in the last midterm elections. We see people getting more involved. We see people taking some responsibility. Surely the days are coming. When we hear of yet another shooting, and we refuse to look at the problems around guns, when we refuse to even have the conversation, when the CDC isn't allowed to look at numbers involved in deaths with guns, we have to take responsibility. But this week, we saw the youth of our country take a stand by walking out on Wednesday. And what amazed me was not the numbers of students walking out in various school districts where they were actually in school, although it was amazing, but come on, high schoolers with an excuse to walk out of school, you can make a case that maybe some of them weren't exactly involved in the whole actual issue. But did you see in the places where school wasn't happening? In the places where it was spring break, there were a lot of students who met at the school to be outside the school, while other students around the country were walking out. They showed up at school in spring break. In Boston, it was a snow day and school was canceled. And the kids still showed up at school to be outside of the school for those 17 minutes. Surely the days are coming. We are in a time of exile. We are in a time of grief. We need to recognize our own culpability. We need to take responsibility. We need to see where we can take action. Get ready to take that action ourselves. We need to recognize and understand that God's time is not our time. When we do those things, then we're ready to hear the message. The days are surely